It's March 26, 2024. We're at the World Health Organization where they're having talks on a pandemic agreement. I'm here with Aggrey. Yeah, well, listen, can you introduce yourself? Tell people who you are and who you represent here. And tell us a little bit about yourself.
Thank you. My name is Aggrey Aluso. I work with Pandemic Action Network as the director for Africa region. And I also double up as the executive director for Resilience Action Network Africa, which is a sister organization to Pandemic Action Network. And I'm here representing the two organizations, and more particularly also bringing the voices of African CSOs who we work very closely with and who have a very, strong hopes and ambitions in the ongoing intergovernmental negotiating body process that is targeted at, bringing about a pandemic agreement that would help us be better prepared, in future for, if we were to have pandemics or to be able to prevent outbreaks before they become pandemics. And I think this is a very important opportunity for humanity coming from this very devastating experience of the COVID-19 where we failed ourselves, basically, because in as much as we ended up in a pandemic situation, which was unfortunate, we had opportunities with the countermeasures and tools that became quickly available. I think there was a very historic speed at really innovating and producing countermeasures, therapeutics, vaccines, and diagnostics. But really where the failure came from was the inability to deploy this equitably and to produce them at scale and get them to help in rolling back the spread of the pandemic in a timely manner that would have really reduced the devastations that was visited upon humanity just because we did not invest much on equity. So my hope for these conversations that are happening here is that we would really learn lessons from that experience and create mechanisms that would help us, get better prepared to, be able to manage and basically contain outbreaks before they become pandemics. But in the event that we end up with pandemics, be able to work in equitable ways that would prevent, the world from going through the challenges that we went through, which are still really impacting humanity and are likely to impact our lives in days to come. So that's why I think this is important. And coming from Africa region, where we really experience a lot of the equity challenges, I think it is particularly critical that whatever outcome is secured from this negotiation, it should be one that helps address the equity challenges that we faced. We want a scenario where we are able to produce our own countermeasures with the support of the world, a world that understands that a threat anywhere can be a threat everywhere, and with with predictable sources of financing that we can call upon and can be deployed quickly on a needs basis and not on any other ground, and of course also with the due cognizance of the differential circumstances of different categories of humanity, those in humanitarian crisis, those in regions with in low resource settings where they don't have, for example, electricity to be able to undertake those very intense cooling, really having all the diversity of humanity at heart, including all the specifics to do with gender, and gender identities and gender, as a whole, and different ages and different contexts in which we all exist in.
Thank you. Given what you know about the negotiations so far, what have you found the most surprising?
What I found most surprising is the apparent lack of appreciation of the challenges that, okay, appreciation, but not, there's appreciation of the challenges that existed, but really not taking those, that knowledge of what challenges we faced and using that info, that knowledge to inform our negotiations, for instance. I think it's been unfortunate that the most contentious areas are the areas that hold the key to equity. You know, areas that would, for example, help us have distributed capacities to produce countermeasures. You know, the technique, the know-how and the tech transfer components, the, you know, potential provisions to provide for time-bound waivers of IPs, you know, are the ones that are not clear. Issues to do with financing, you know, really creating a financing mechanism that is coordinated, that is predictable, that is democratically governed, that would really not expose us to the whimsical, unpredictable sources of financing that we saw in Act A, where there were several pledges that were not fulfilled. We don't want a pandemic preparedness and response agenda being subject to, you know, to different discretional considerations, because we know we cannot rely on such arrangements. Yet, we don't seem to have clarity in those directions. And of course, the critical area of pathogen access and benefit sharing has been one of the most contentious ones. And this is really an article or a provision that would help us, you know, incentive us, should be able to help create an ecosystem that countries are, you know, excited and happy to share, you know, when they come across pathogens that require, you know, intervention quickly enough, and be assured that they will get support or they will get benefits that accrue from their sharing, incentivizing that sharing and, you know, really creating a system that also rewards those who are able to share their, you know, information, critical information that would help us make the tool. So those are some of the contentious issues. And of course, the governance component, really creating a high level, we had really hoped to have a head of state level kind of accountability mechanism, governance mechanism anchored at the head of state level, where we can be able to galvanize and coordinate the whole of society, whole of governance, government coordination. Yet that doesn't seem to be heading in that direction. So, and of course, having provisions that are entrenched in accountability frameworks, that we can be able to rely on, you know, on them being implemented and enforced, because the provisions demand such. We are not seeing language that is strong enough and compelling to extract the kind of accountability we would want for this kind of important document. So I think, for me, those would have been important things to get from this process, and I hope, even with the limited time that is still here, that we would end up with, even if not in the exact forms, not in the very specific ways that I'm saying them, but at least something that puts us on a path towards dependable and enforceable provisions that touch on those issues that I've mentioned previously. Thank you.
I'd like to thank you very much. You've really provided a pretty detailed walkthrough of issues that are important in this negotiation, and so I, you know, we'll have to see how things go. But I think it's great that you're here. Thank you.
Thank you very much.